I look at my daddy, 85 years old. I was kidding somebody. I said, if you ever get in one of those certain rough battles and you wonder if there's a God, if he even exists, I said, find my daddy and follow him about 15 miles. The way my daddy drives, you realize there's a great big God that's took care of John Wynn. And but I look at my dad, he's been preaching the gospel over 50 years. And his little heart, he's this particular year, 85 years old, he'll eat all of 1 week, then the next week he eats one meal a day. So he spent half of this year fasting, and he probably weighs about 140 pounds, and his little heart's so gentle. And I was kidding him something the other day, and I was telling him, I said, Dave, what do you want? And he said, oh, I just want to get closer to the Lord. Just gotten conviction being around him. And he preached for us the other day, and he held up his little old Bible, and he said, I was up at 6 o'clock praying. And he said, I said, Lord, this is all I've got, but it's enough. Hallelujah. How many know Jesus is enough? He's enough. He's enough. So my thought or my motive, and I've touched along this line before, but I couldn't go any other direction. But my thought or my motive for preaching tonight is I want to be standing when the battle's over. I want you and I to be one that finished the race. Lot's going to start that won't endure to the end. But I didn't start to quit. Didn't start to look back and tend to make heaven my home. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to finish this race. So what's it going to take? What's some things it's going to take to finish this race? If I could speak to your heart just for a few minutes. There's scripture talked about, and it's one I wrestle with. There's a lot of scriptures I have questions about, and I have a little shelf in my heart. My daddy taught me, and I put it on this shelf, and I get it down, and I pray about it, and I run reference, and I pray about it, and I talk about it, and I look up commentaries, and sooner or later, God will give me the answer, and I'll move on to another scripture. But one scripture I used to wrestle with was Adam was a type of Christ. And that scripture just, man, what is he saying? Adam, a type of Christ? Adam, in the way you look at it in the carnal, was just the biggest loser. Because of Adam, there's sickness, there's things you spoke of. Because of Adam's failure, there's heartaches, there's trouble, there's death, there's pain, there's tears, there's sorrow, there's anguish because of Adam. And the Bible said Adam was a type of Christ. But when I come to Christ, when I come to Jesus, all I see is mercy and hope and love and forgiveness. And he that loved me while I was yet a sinner, and he that loved me when I was running from him, the one that gave me a second chance, whose blood covers all my sin. So I pondered, where was Adam a type of Christ? Where did this come into being at? And I see Adam in a garden, and I see that God had made him in his likeness, in his image, and he took a rib out, and he made a helpmeet, and I see Adam in the garden. Rusty Goodman used to sing, and there was peace and there was harmony in the garden. But one morning, God, the voice of God comes to the garden in the cool of the day, and something was different. God's looking for Adam, and another part of the garden, I can see Adam, and he comes back, and there's Eve, and she's partook of the tree, and Adam's looking at her, and he said, what's going on? And she tells him the story of the serpent, and she explains to him, and he says, honey, what have you done? What have you done? And immediately, he tries to pull her back to his God nature. Immediately, he tries to restore her back to that she's fallen from, and he tries so hard all through Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy. I see the Lord trying to pull us to him. I see him send judges and prophets, and I see him send psalmists and prophetess, the little Deborah's trying to pull us to him. And sometimes we get close, so close to him, but we always turned and went back to our old ways. And I see Adam, honey, I can't live without you. I want you. And I see him pulling on her and pulling on her. And in Romans, it said this creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but reason of him who had subject the same in hope. And I can see Adam, but now there's a horrible horrible warfare going on in his spirit. He's saying, I want God. I love God so much. God, you mean everything to me, but I want Eve. And I can't live without Eve. And I just can't go on without Eve. And if I have God, I can't have Eve. And if I have Eve, I can't have God. And I don't know what to do. If I stay in this God nature, I can't be one with you. But if I step down with you, I can't have the harmony that I've had with God and the life, and with no death and no sickness and no troubles. And I don't know what to do. And the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly. And he had such a love for Eve that he looks at God and he's wiping a tear and he says, God, I love you so much, but you made me this way and you put a love inside of me for this woman. And he stepped down from life, and he stepped down from health and peace, and he stepped down into the Adam nature. And 4,000 years later, I see another garden. I see a warfare going on, and I hear Jesus cry, I don't want to go through this. Let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, I love my bride so much. I love my church so much that I'm willing to cry, why has thou forsaken me? I'm willing to step away that I can have my bride back. And somebody ought to thank him for dying for us. And go with me to this garden just for a few minutes. And Jesus, he's not brought the 5,000 nor the 4,000. He's not even brought the 70. In fact, he didn't even bring the 11 faithful. Out of those 11, he picked 3 men. And he said, will you go with me to pray? Will you go with me? I'm facing something as I've never faced before. And he goes to the garden and he gets down and he helps the 3 men find their altar. And the Bible said he went a little further and he prayed and he came back and they've fallen asleep. And he said, can't you watch with me? Can't you pray with me 1 hour? And he's begging them, please pray with me. Please pray with me. And finally they fall asleep. And the Bible says he went a little further and he cries, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Somewhere about that time, there's a noise. There's a commotion. And here comes Judas with the one that's betrayed him and sold him. And here comes Judas with the crowd. And he didn't kick Jesus and he didn't spit on Jesus. He didn't even point his finger at Jesus. He went over and he kissed him on the jaw. And when he told him, he said, whoever I kiss, that'll be the one for you to take. And he kissed him on the jaw. According to the writings of Luke, Jesus had been in such intense prayer in the garden that his veins and his pores had literally opened up, and his sweat had begun, blood had begun to drain through his skin. And they say there's a place of just such mental intense pressure. I've read 3 different physician books where your pores will open. And apparently Jesus carrying my weight upon him and all my problems upon him, and he loved me so much. His pores is open and blood is mingled with sweat and it's running down his face. And when Judas, one of the chosen 12, kisses the face of Jesus, he's one of the first ones we read about. The second one we read about, that the blood of Jesus touches him. And when the blood of Jesus touches him, could I tell somebody, this was a preacher who had been around him for 3.5 years, but it wasn't touching him to justify him. It wasn't touching him to say you're covered and you're forgiven. It was touching him in eternity. He'll cry out against him and he'll say, son, you got close enough to kiss the door to heaven and you turned and walked away. Could I beg somebody in the house tonight, just because you're in church on a Monday night, we're still not home yet. There's a decision you'll have to make tomorrow and the next day and the next day. Choose you this day whom you will serve. Don't you let somebody tell you because you went to the altar yesterday, you're sealed, friend. You've got to choose today whom you will serve, and you ought to make up your mind, my soul's not for sale. I'm not going to look back. I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to turn back. I want him more than I want anything. We don't know if they brought a rope. We don't know if Judas being the treasure, we don't know if they ripped the money bag off of him. And perhaps a rope that went around his waist, they tie the little hands of Jesus. Perhaps one even had a leather rope with them. We don't know. But I can see these old mean soldiers. They weren't a nice deputy or a nice police officer. They didn't come to arrest him. They came to destroy him. They didn't come to make him submit. They came to crush him and to destroy him. him, and I can see him dragging Jesus away. And we've all read different accounts of how the trial had so many faults within it. If it was tried in a legal court, it would have immediately been thrown away. But they lied on him, and they tried different things to bring the trial up, and he stood there in silence. One of your greatest witnesses when hell's coming against you on your job, it's not arguing back or it's fussing back. It's just biting your tongue and keeping a right spirit. Created me a clean heart, oh God. Some of Jesus's loudest messages are not always written in red. Some of the loudest ones, some of the most precious ones, it's just when he's being lied on and he stood there, he had nothing to prove. He knew who he was. Hallelujah. Friend, you know who you are. You're not a drunk anymore. I don't care what they say. You know who you are. You're not who you used to be and who they say they are. Somebody ought to hold their head up and say, by the grace of God, I have nothing to prove. It's under the blood. It's gone, and I am who I am by the grace of God. I'm not who I used to be. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Yes. He's standing there, and the Word stood alone. He's standing there, and he who was the beginning of the creation of God stands there and cries, I thirst. He's standing there going through all this, all he's facing, all he's encountering. Standing there. They pass him from one place to another. Matthew 26:48. Now he that betrayed him gave them a sign, saying, whomsoever I shall kiss, the same as he, hold him fast. This is the one. Matthew 26:56. All this was done that the scripture of the prophets might be fulfilled. Then the disciples forsook him and fled. Peter denies, says, I don't know him. I'm not one of them. I'm not with him. John 19:16, they delivered him there forth unto to be crucified, and they took Jesus and led him away. And he bearing his cross went forth unto a place called the skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha. When they crucified him, two others with him on either side, one Jesus in the midst. I want to ask you now, what was it that kept driving Jesus? What was it that kept pushing Jesus? They say perhaps one standing here at the beginning of the journey, and he said Jesus carries his cross, but on up the road stands another rider, and Jesus being tired, they say the cross weighed anywhere from 170 to 250 pound perhaps. And Jesus must have stumbled under the weight of that cross. They pull a little man out of the crowd and say, will you carry this cross? And as a little child, I remember I used to think, I'd hear my daddy preach along this line, I'd have loved to have been there and help my Jesus carry his cross. But I read another scripture, as much as you do this to the least of my little ones, you've done it unto me. Somebody wants to find favor with God, help somebody carry their cross. Somebody wants to please the Lord. Help someone whose load is heavy and they don't know what to do and which way to turn. And I feel the sweet presence of the Lord in this place tonight. They get up to the top of the hill. They're professional crucifiers. And I don't know what order they crucified the three men there that day. I don't know whether it's two thieves first or Jesus, but I can see them probably the first two are aggressive and they're cursing and they're fighting. And I can see throw one of them down on the cross. And I can see him driving the nails and maybe putting a rope around his middle. And he's swinging and he's cussing. And one's holding his knee down and he's holding. They come to the next. And they get Jesus and I can see him throw him down. And I'm not sure. I like to think about it. But I can almost see my gentle Jesus look up and said, you don't have to hold me down. I came to die. You'll have to put your knee on me. I'm not going to fight you. There's a John out there, and there's a Joe, and there's a Glenn. Hallelujah. That wants me. Lots of you may reject me, but somebody's going to want my forgiveness. I came to die. I'm not going to struggle with you. Hallelujah. I'm not going to fight with you. And I can see him bringing the hammer down and the nails tearing his little hands in his feet. The left foot is now pressed backward against the right foot and with both feet extended, toes down. A nail is driven through the arch of each, leaving the knees flex. The victim is now crucified. The cross is raised and dropped into the hole. His flesh tears again. Jesus loved us while we were in a mess. Jesus loved us not just while we were in church preaching. He didn't just love us when we were doing the right thing. He loved us while we were yet sinners. Hallelujah. I said he loved us while we were yet sinners. Hallelujah. Hanging by his arms, the muscles are paralyzed and almost unable to act after a while. Air can be drawn into his lungs, but it's so hard to exhale it. Jesus fights to raise himself up in order to even get one short breath. Finally, carbon dioxide builds up in his lungs and the bloodstream and the cramps partially subside. But when it's not all about you, friend, hallelujah. Can I preach to somebody tonight? We live in a real religious generation. I live in the mid Tennessee. We're at the headquarters of the Church of God, and there's religion all around us, but we live right in, we call it the Bible Belt, even down in this area. And then I meet so many religious people, but can I tell you, religion might be okay. You might even stay in church when everything's going good, but if dead religion is all you got, when there comes a cross in your life, you'll throw it down and you'll walk away. The only thing that's going to keep me and you, we've got to fall in love with Jesus again. It wasn't nailed that held him to the cross. It wasn't the mean soldiers that held him to the cross. It was his love for me and you that held Jesus to that cross. Hallelujah. As a pastor, as a minister, we beg you to stay in church. We beg you to be faithful to the house of God, to live right and to walk right. But can I tell somebody, sooner or later, that old wooden cross is rot and them old nails rust in too. And if that's all that's hanging you to a cross is you're nailed up there and you're going to church to keep your family together and you're going to church to please your mom and your daddy, if it's only nails hanging you, holding you to your cross, sooner or later they'll rust in two and you'll throw your hands down and you'll walk away. But if you're here because you love Jesus, you'll be here when everything's good. You'll be here when doctors are shaking their heads. You'll be here when you don't know how you're going to pay your bills. You'll be here when you lay awake and you cry all night. And I wish somebody would pray him out loud. If you love the Lord, hallelujah, I want to preach a few minutes, but would somebody stand to your feet, say, God, before I leave this building tonight, would you let me fall in love with you again? Hallelujah. Would somebody say that? Hallelujah. 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 Would somebody just pray that little prayer out loud? Lamb of God, let me fall in love with you again. Let my heart be tender towards you again. I got hurt and wounded and discouraged, and I've got busy, and I've made church about a lot of things. I made a whole lot of it about me, but it never was about me, Jesus. Would you let me fall in love with you again? Would you let my reasons and my motives of reason I'm doing what I'm doing, would you remind me? It's because I love you. I love you. I love you. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I feel anointed in here to heal a wounded heart. I feel anointed in here to mend a cold heart tonight. Hallelujah. I believe the Spirit of God's going to visit us in this place tonight. If we'll all pray together, Lord, I want to fall in love with you again. I want to pray because I love you. I want to live right because I love you. I don't want to do it just to please somebody. I want to do it because I'm in love with you. I don't want to live this way just to fit in. I want to do this because I'm in love with you. You can be seated just for a moment. When it's not about me and you and there's no glory, no pats on the back. Nails will rust and wood will rot and we'll walk away. Matthew 16:24 then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Matthew 27:40. Thou hast to destroy the temple, then build it in 3 days, save thyself. Oh, you said you built temples, save yourself when they're mocking you, when they're mocking your gift, when they're laughing at you, wood will rotten, nails will rust, and we'll come down. But if we're there just because we love him, if we're there just because we love him, hours of limitless pain, cycles of twisting, joints rending, tissues torn from his lacerated back as he moves up and down against the rough timbers, then another agony begins, a terrible crushing pain deep in his chest as the heart cavity slowly fills with serum and begins to compress the heart. It's now almost over. The loss of tissue fluid has reached a critical level. The compressed heart is struggling to pump heavy, thick, sluggish blood into the tissues. The tortured lungs are making a frantic effort to gasp in gulps of air. Matthew 27:42, he saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the king, won't he come down from that cross and we'll believe him? Jesus is not Las Vegas. You don't put in a quarter and get $1 million. You got to realize all of our reaping's not on this side. Hallelujah. All of our reaping's not on this side. Hallelujah. I love the story of the little missionary. He went out over and gave his life to Africa, and he preached there, and he's on the ship, and he comes home, and there's a multitude. They're throwing confetti, and the band's marching, and he's so excited. Then he realized that it wasn't for him. It was a politician on the ship, and he's looking around for some of his church, or he'd wrote several to meet him, and nobody was there to meet him. And he whispers to the Lord. He said, Lord, I'm not complaining. I've given my whole life to you. I wish somebody would have been here. The man, he's given his life to America politics, and there was thousands to meet him and nobody to meet me. I came home and nobody to meet me. And the Lord whispered to him, he told later, he said, son, that man's home, that's his reward, but you're not home yet. There's a reward waiting on you. Hallelujah. Can I tell somebody, don't look for your reward down here. We're fixing to go home, friend. We're laying up treasures in heaven where moth and rust can't corrupt and where thieves don't break through and steal. I feel Jesus in this house right now. Let them have it all. Give us the favor of God. Give us the heart of God. Let me hear the voice of my beloved. When they mock you, why are you doing this? And they turn away. Wood will rot, nails will rust, and you'll get down off your cross and you'll leave church and you'll say, I want nothing to do with it. It's not working for me. But if you love the Lord, when you don't understand him, you'll be there. When you love the Lord and the heavens are silent, you'll be there. When you love the Lord and you're going through the dark, lonely night, you'll be there. Somebody ought to let the devil know, devil, I'm here because I love the Lord. Hallelujah. Your life's already preached this little sermon. There's some folk in here. It may not have been your easiest year. Somebody ought to tell the devil, look here, devil, hallelujah, it's not been a bed of roses. I've not loved him because of the blessings. I've cried this year more than I've shouted. Look here, devil, I'm still here. I'm here, hallelujah, not because of the shout. I've not shouted a lot this year. I'm not here because of the joy. I've carried a lot of battles this year. I'm here because I love my Jesus, hallelujah. Oh, somebody go ahead. I feel a strength in this house tonight. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. In fact, about 35 years of ministry, I've only felt this type of strength a few times, but I literally feel a strength from heaven coming down. Coming down and touching some men and women in here tonight. I believe God's smiling on some folk in Murfreesboro, Arkansas. God looks down and says, I didn't give them everything they wanted and they didn't quit. I didn't hate you. Hallelujah. I've been silent. I've eased back a little bit. I've let the devil know I've got some people that love me, not because I'm a wish giver, not because I'm some magic wand. I've got some people that love me because I'm God, and they love me. They don't love me just for their blessings. They don't love me just for the miracles. They fell in love with me because I'm the Lord. When somebody tell him out loud, I've fallen in love with you, Jesus. I've not fallen in love with your pocketbook. I've not fallen in love with your miracles. I've not not falling in love. We got a lot of people in America, they're in love with his signs and wonders, and when it stops or eases back, they walk away. But God's got some people, we're just simply in love with the Lord. We just love the Lord. We just love the Lord. Somebody give him a praise in this house. Oh, I praise you, Jesus. 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 I hear him on the cross. Matthew 15:30, save thyself. Come down from the cross. When people belittle you and they hurt you and your family, they turn and they rend your heart. If only nails are holding you, if only the wood's holding you, wood will rot, nails will rust, and you'll walk away. I've seen so many precious people walk away from the ministry and walk away from God and walk away from church, and I realize they weren't there because they loved the Lord. They never went further enough to fall in love with him. John 21:16, he saith on him a second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He said unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. He said unto him, feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. When you sing and you encourage them and they don't encourage you, when you pour into them and they don't pour back into you, when you help them in their time of need and in your battles, when you're on your cross, they stand away out there and they say, I don't know you. If only nails is holding you to your cross, you'll walk away. But at the end of the day, if you're doing this cause you love the Lord, hallelujah. If you're doing this cause you love the Lord, if you're doing this cause you love the Lord, hallelujah. I know this is a tiny bit different, but I wish somebody just said out loud, I'm here cause I love the Lord. I'm just here, I love you, Jesus. I love you, hallelujah. Y'all be honest, I don't always understand him, but I sure love him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I appreciate you, Lamb of God. I love you, Jesus. I love you a lot. I love you a lot. Matthew 27:46. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which is say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Where are you at? Where are you at? In your dry times, in your deserts. And if you live for God long enough, there will be deserts. If you live for God long enough, there will be moments of silence. If you live for God long enough, you will not shout every day. And people that's not in this thing because they love the Lord, they give up and they walk away. But if you're in this because you love the Lord, because you love the Lord, I don't want to preach too hard tonight, but I wish you'd look at your own heart and you'd say, Lord, why am I living for you? Am I living for you just because I'm afraid of going to hell? Am I living for you just because I'm about to lose my family? Am I living for you just because I need a touch or a miracle? And that you need to be honest tonight. Different things. God uses different things to bring us to him. But in the process, we need to fall in love with him. Somewhere in those answered prayers and him touching us and healing our homes and helping us, somewhere we need to fall in love with him in such a way that no matter what comes and goes, we make up our mind, I'm not going to leave you. I'm not going to walk away from you. I need you more than the air I breathe. I need you. I need you, Lord. I need you. I really need you. Matthew 27:36. And sitting down, they watched him there and said over his head, the accusation's written, this is Jesus, King of the Jews. When they're mocking and they're laughing, and the enemy and demons are mocking and laughing. Midnight hour, when your load's heavy and the enemy whispers, God loves you, why are you going through this? If God loves you, why is he allowing you to face this? If you be the King of the Jews, you come down. the midnight hour when the enemy's mocking you, if you're only in this because of religion to please people, you'll say, well, he probably don't love me. I'm just going to give up. But if you're in this because you love the Lord, hallelujah. If you're in this because you love the Lord. I remember the second funeral I preached many, many years ago. And it was Brother Grizzle. His little, in Gainesville, Georgia, his little legs were twisted up to his chest. And his little precious wife for over 17 years every day. She got to where she couldn't turn him or pick him up no more. She put him in a nursing home and moved close to it, and every day she would sit by him 6 or 7 hours every day. And when I preached that funeral, she stood there by him, and she wasn't grumbling or complaining. I remember the last thing I heard her say, she said, I love you so much. You meant so much to me. It's easy to love each other when everything's going good. But I've seen people walk away. But if you love them because of who they are, and I feel the Holy Ghost in here right now. Can I tell somebody, I'd love to preach this soon, but I've worked on this over for a long time, and I've felt some good thoughts late last night and today, but I've pondered about that silence in heaven. What is that silence in heaven? And I've heard people say, you know, when we're going to look at the devil, we're going to realize he's not that big. What is that silence in heaven? What can that be when that and it even puts a limit on it, tell us how long it is. What is that silence in heaven? But I found that immediately after it talks about the prayers of the saints were released and they went up before God. And so I've just got a fresh thought going on in my heart, and I can see old Job present himself before the Lord, and he says, you know that I can see the devil, excuse me, present himself before the Lord and call Job's name and said, you know that Job said if you'd just ease back on him a little bit, he'd just quit and he'd give up and he'd throw in the towel and he'd just backslide. And I can see the Lord cross his hand and he said, devil, I got a lot of people out there, if I don't bless them and if I don't anoint them, they're going to quit. But you don't understand what Job's made out of. Job loves me because I'm the Lord. And if I don't do what Job wants, Job's still going to be true to me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I think right now in this generation, there's those of us, we're going through a moment of silence in heaven. I believe that same wicked one has presented himself before the throne and he's looked down. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Please don't get mad at your pastor, but I feel anointed to preach. But I believe he's looked down at this name and claim it. And he said, God, if you didn't do what these people want, they'd all backslide and walk away. And the Lord must have grinned at the devil. And he said, devil, I got some folk in the land. They don't love me just because of miracles. And they don't love me just because of blessings. And I hear the devil sneer and say, well, prove it to me. And I believe God's crossed his arm in the last few months and year or two in America. And I believe there's been a silence in heaven. We've prayed and some things we've prayed about's not turned around. We've prayed and some things we've sought God for is not turned around. And I believe the enemy's standing off and he thought I was going to backslide and you was going to backslide. But God loved you so much and God trusted you so much that in the heavens, hallelujah, wiping a tear, God crossed his arm and he said, devil, I'm going to show you. Hallelujah. This is not Job's day. This is 2000. This is Anthony's day and John's day. And I'm going to cross my arms. Hallelujah. And I'm going to show you I've got some men and women that's not for sale. I got some men and women that don't love me just for ministry and the anointing and the gifts. I got some people they're not going to quit and they're not going to slow down. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Somebody ought to worship the Lord out loud. Hallelujah. And as I begin to dig into this, if that's what's going on right now, immediately after it, something fresh begins to happen in prayer. Immediately after this silence, the prayers of the saints begin to come up before God. The prayers of the saints on the golden altar. Hallelujah. So I'm telling somebody, I think our generation has been going through a season of silence in heaven, but somebody start praying. I believe heaven's listening. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to seek God. You ought to lay between the porch and the altar. Say, Lord, I wrote this thing out. Hallelujah. I didn't love you because of the blessing. I didn't love you because of the fish and loaves. Hallelujah. There been no fish and loaves, but I'm still here. I'm still here. I fell in love with my beloved. I hear the voice of my beloved. Come away, my fair one. Rise, my love. My fair one, come away. Can I tell you, we
you're going through a quiet season and a hard season. Your old drug buddies come back around. And heaven's silent. And you're crossed and your load's heavy. And your bills are hard to pay. You know you could go buy and sell and trade and find some mental ease. If you're only on this because you're nailed to your cross, you'll get down and you'll walk away. When your old friends are there offering you where you used to be, if you're doing this because you love the Lord, you'll wipe a tear and you'll say, I still love Him. I still love Him. I still love Him. I still love Him.